The feature for tonight is really Mayor Curtatone introducing Chris Lineberger and Locus. And so I want to turn it over to them. And I think they'll have time for public comment. And they can take it whenever they want. And we haven't introduced all the aldermen here, so I'm going to ask the mayor to recognize them.
Thank you, Wade. See if I quick test. I do want to recognize Alderman Niedergang. I walked in with Alderman Valentine, so that was an easy one. Alderman Waters, Alderman Rossetti, and Alderman McLaughlin. As I reminded him, he missed an appointment with me this morning. But anyway, I hope everyone's having a good summer. Certainly better than the winter. And let's all enjoy whatever you're doing, every moment of it. I know I'm trying to. I first want to thank Wick, Seymour, and Tate, the entire CAC for all their hard work and participation, but all of you who've come to all the meetings. I purposely don't try to stay away, to look from afar and allow every stakeholder who wanted to participate to allow that room. And I really want to say that I thank you for elevating the dialogue. I think at the end of the day, whatever the narrative is, it's going to be quite a legacy for the community, for the city, for the people who live here, work here, who invest here, for the rest of the country. Our goal is to align what I've learned from some great examples, having been in Assembly Row today, Assembly Square, on the power of this, to align governance and leadership and planning and community empowerment and a common future. So I want to thank you for what you're doing. And one of the issues I know that has been certainly impressed upon us is, you know, what about the issue of community benefits? And what I've tried to explain is what I've learned, what I thought community benefits were, you know, over 20 years in the political career as an alderman, as a mayor. It's far beyond any check somebody writes us. How do we align our plans, our social values of a community, our needs and our wants, along with the private sector? How do we develop a transparent approach? How do we develop a model that is self-sustaining beyond any political administration? And again, continue to empower community and inspire civic engagement to manage and measure and invest in the values we care about. That's our goal. It's not something as easy to put down in the four corners of a document. So what we have resisted on our end is what the temptation and the lure has been in years past, was to sit down in a room with any private sector developer and say, these are the things we want, here's what you need to pay, here's what you need to do. And then some of it sort of dissipates, some of it sort of fades, and some of them are hard infrastructure benefits and so forth. But what is important, what we know for us in this community, and through the dialogue from all of you and many of you, what we see around the country is the disparity between social progress and economic growth. How do we align those values? The United States ranks near the top in GDP, ranks 16th in social progress in the world. We have concerns. Part of our DNA is, you know, the choice to be able to afford to be here, the want to participate in what occurs here and grow together, the values of the community and housing and keeping things local and maintaining our diversity, our originality, our creativity, and many, many more things. That is spelled out well in Summer Vision. How do we measure that? How do we map that? How do we measure that? How do we manage that and grow that over time? Those are the questions I have. So, in our pursuit and getting some great feedback from people, the community, and other models around the country, I had the chance to speak to Christopher Lineberger and members of Locus, and we were looking for an opportunity to set to show Somerville as really a national model, how we can engage and empower the community to manage these values, measure these values, and invest in them in the long term. And really be a model for the entire country. So I'm going to have Chris talk a little bit about himself and Locus, but what I want to impress upon you, what we're seeking is someone to partner and facilitate with us that dialogue, that work, to maintain the work still within the community. What I want to say tonight is our intent is not to negotiate these issues behind closed doors. We want it to be transparent, we want it to be engaged, we want you to be involved, and you need to do the work. I don't know where this ends up. And I want to press upon this is more about instilling an idea of an approach that is unique, that is innovative. There are some models around the country, but I think what we're talking about here for some of them would be quite unique. So if you'd indulge me with your flexibility and time, I'd like to introduce, I'm a big fan of his. He's a renowned economist. He's very much involved in Locus. He speaks worldwide. He's a big fan of Somerville. Chris Lineberger. Chris.
Good to be here. I cut my teeth about 2 miles from here. I spent the requisite 2 years here in Boston at Arlington Town Center and commuting on the bus down to Harvard Square and walking across that ungodly freezing bridge over to the B School. And then my son just left here. He got his PhD at MIT, so he was in Porter Square, so very close to him. We're here to talk about your future and where it's going, and hopefully lay out a process that hopefully you'll like. If not, that's fine, because we don't have to be here. We are here at the request of the mayor, and we've met with Ann and with Wig, but we're being funded by the Barr Foundation, and primarily because of the environmental concerns that the Barr Foundation has. And actually, that's the reason I'm involved with Locus. That one of the things that the research has shown is that building walkable urban places is the number one way we're going to address climate change. And this country, as you know, is the worst emitter of greenhouse gases. And it's because we're so wasteful and we have sprawled all over creation. And the answer to that is now what the market wants. It didn't want it when I lived here 40 years ago. And it didn't want it 20 years ago. But over the last generation, the market has fundamentally changed and is demanding what you have here in Somerville. It's now a matter of giving the market what it wants, and in the process, A, becoming a much wealthier community as far as the kind of tax revenues that you can generate that will allow you to do a lot of interesting things. And number two is that it will address the issue of climate change. But the issue of climate change will only be addressed if we also deal with social equity. Our definition of social equity is a combination of housing affordability and transportation accessibility. Most of us in the urbanism world understand that that you have to look at both. And you look at household spending on both housing and transportation, and that we, in essence, have to shift our household spending from a macroeconomic point of view from cars, sending the money to Detroit and our friends in Venezuela and Saudi Arabia, and shifting it to spending that money on housing, on education, on savings, and keeping it local. That's going to be the big macro shift over the next generation, and it's already happening because of this trend towards walkable urban development. So what we want to lay out for you, if you want it, is a strategic planning process for Union Square for both economic growth and social equity. That nobody wants to build an Upper East Side or a Central Paris, which is a golden ghetto, and push everybody out, all of the others out. This has got to be a mixed income place if it's really successful. The question is how to achieve it. Let me give you some background, first up on myself, that I've been involved in real estate and urbanism since I was a tyke, being involved in understanding how the city of Philadelphia worked, which is where I grew up, working with teenage gangs in the city when I was in college, during the nasty late 60s, early 70s, as we were tearing our cities apart, throwing them away, rushing out to the countryside. For 20 years, I ran the country's largest real estate and urban consulting planning firm, and worked on hundreds of projects throughout the country. But the work that I did there that was most relevant is working on downtown strategies in places like downtown Chattanooga and Lancaster and Detroit to help them figure out how they could turn themselves around. And all of them are doing, quite honestly, very well, thank you very much. Even Detroit. I may have lost all credibility, but Detroit's kicking butt. And after I sold that firm, I got into real estate development, doing downtown redevelopment in the rail yards in Santa Fe, downtown Albuquerque, starting the redevelopment process. But now, this is my think tanky academic advocacy time of life. So I'm a senior fellow at Brookings. I run the real estate and urban affairs program at George Washington University, and I'm president of LOCUS. So LOCUS is part of Smart Growth America. How many of you know the phrase smart growth? So about half of you. Smart growth is basically anti-sprawl. It is to build mixed use, mixed income, walkable urban places, and to allow it to happen legally, because it's illegal in 95% of this country, and to stop subsidizing the other. We're massively subsidizing the other form of development, low-density, drivable suburban stuff. Smart Growth America is the national advocacy organization. It includes Complete Streets, the Governor's Institute, Transportation for America, LOCUS, and Andre LaRue is here. Andre is part of the local Commonwealth Smart Growth Organization. They're part of SGA. Raise your hand. There we go. So Smart Growth America, Jeff Anderson, who ran the Smart Growth Division at EPA before he came over to SGA, Jeff asked me to start a developer organization that would be populated by real estate developers that want to do smart growth. Again, mixed use, mixed income, walkable urban development that's environmentally sustainable. So I've always felt in real estate, there's 20-30% of developers that are what I refer to as double or triple bottom line types, looking to make a buck, but to do social equity and to do environmentally sustainable kinds of development. So we've organized that 20-30% into LOCUS to advocate on the national level. By the way, the name is Latin for place. Now, my wife's the classicist, so she's the one that came up with it. But obviously, this is all about placemaking. Everything about smart growth is creating a place that you can be proud of. And unlike the other way of building, drivable suburban, by the way, is the technical name for it, the low-density sprawl, that stuff is driven by formula. There's what I've always referred to as the 19 standard product types that we in the U.S. could build. All those, you ever wonder why the country looks the same? Why a shopping mall here in Boston looks the same as in California, except for out in California, they put little Mediterranean tiles on the roof, and here you make it look New England, old New England-y. That it's a formula. And it's the same formula that allows those centers to be traded like pork bellies, because they're all commodities. Walkable urban places, smart growth places, grow from the dirt. They are could only be here kind of places. And that's why it's important. I mean, that's why you're here. I mean, you're trying to create something that is could only be Union Square. And if you don't, you've not only lost an opportunity, the market's going to not be very happy with what you generate. So, and as I say, this work here is being funded by the Barr Foundation. They reached out to us and said, we need to get our developers organized to do this kind of development. LOCUS also started our social equity initiative, and our focus right now is on Metro DC and Metro Boston to craft a model for the country, because the only way to demonstrate this stuff is on the ground. You can talk theoretically about it. I've written books about it, tons of articles. But until you can show it on the ground and people can kick it and walk it and understand it, it doesn't count. At the federal level, we're very active. In fact, Christopher Coe's here. Christopher, stand up. Christopher is our managing director and is deeply involved right now, this minute, on dealing with, on Capitol Hill, with the transportation bill, which is moving, thank God. Couldn't believe that those bozos actually find a way to get to work. And they actually were working on Sunday on this, which is shocking. And not your senators. Your senators are fabulous. They really are. They are really great. Berkeley is just, he's just an amazing guy. So we're working on the transportation bill, working on tax reform, so we stop subsidizing all the wrong stuff. At the state level, working on the ground implementation like this. We also bring together cities and towns and try to help them get ready, and then bring together developers that could do the kind of development that those cities want. And it's what we call link-ups. And there'll be some stuff as far as at the State House that we might be involved with, again, working with Andre and working with others here. And then research. We've done a lot of research, and some of this comes out of GW, where, again, I run the Real Estate Research Center. We just finished the walk-up, wake-up call from Metro Boston. And I'm going to go through some of the findings in just a second. You know, the thing about building the built environment, which, by the way, accounts for a mere 35% of the wealth of our society. It's the largest asset class. Real estate, infrastructure like the school, roads, you add it all up, it's the largest asset class. And for hundreds of years, when we built the built environment, we built towns like Somerville, what we refer to as walkable urban. Higher density, mix of usage, many ways to get there as far as transportation, but once you're there, it's walkable, which means that these places must be small because we only want to walk so far. You know, we want to walk about a half mile or so before we start looking for an alternative means of transportation. So go back to your, since we're in school, high school. Think about geometry, pi r squared. It limits the size of these places. So these walkable urban places tend to be 50 to 400 acres. That's it. Union Square is about 130. It falls right in the middle. So we used to do this a lot, as almost everything you see around shows. But during the last half of the 20th century, we pushed this pendulum all the way over, and virtually all we built was drivable suburban. It's what the market wanted. And real estate delivered, and we abandoned places like Somerville. So when I was here, the only reason to come to Somerville in my mind, now I'm a student with limited budget, but you did have Steve's ice cream. And so I would go around, you know, wait around the corner and wind through that line, and this stunning thing to make your own ice cream, pretty cool. But we abandoned our cities, and much of it was race driven. We wanted to be away from them, whoever the local them was. And so when you look at metropolitan development trends in this country, if you know three things, you know how we built every one of our metro areas. If you know where the white upper middle income housing concentration is, and it always concentrates. If you know where the local minority housing concentration is, and if you know where the freeways were built, you can figure out where there is what is referred to as the favored quarter, the favored 90-degree arc coming out of downtown, which is where all the white folk live, all the executives live, and 80%, 90% of all job growth went for 50 years. And so in Washington, it goes to the northwest. In Atlanta, it goes to the north. In Kansas City, it goes to the south. Denver goes to the south. And here, it, of course, goes to the west. And that's where opportunity was, and that's where job growth was, that's where tax growth was, and we threw away much of the rest. So as to understand that Brookings and GW are as academically rigorous as Harvard, Tufts, and MIT, I make my students watch popular movies. And the most important popular movie about real estate and about the built environment is Back to the Future. Hands down. It is the only movie, popular movie, that shows the two ways of building the built environment, walkable urban, drivable suburban, in the same film over three different time periods. And they nailed it. My grandfather always said, tell what's going to happen or when it's going to happen, but never both. Well, these guys did both. So this first clip I want to show you, and we don't have audio, but it's just music, and I can hum the words, that shows you downtown Hill Valley in 1955. By the way, Hill Valley, the name, and this is a fictional town, that the writers, really smart guys out at Universal Studios back 83, 84, that they took a page out of Real Estate Developer 101 book, which is that you name your project after what you destroy. So Hill Valley, you push the hill into the valley, Hill Valley natural. So here is downtown Hill Valley in 1955, which was, you know, how we used to build our places like Somerville. And I think you'll understand just how lovely it was. Now, if we had the music, I would blast you with the very well-known music. But here we go. Here is downtown Hill Valley, plaza in the center, civic building up there on the right, retail on the ground floor, office and residential up above. A pretty idyllic place. This was how we used to build everywhere USA. It was a point of pride, and the people that built those buildings tend to overinvest in them because A, they were proud, B, they were local, C, they were building for the long term. They weren't building to build and flip and get out of Dodge. So let's fast forward to downtown Hill Valley in 1985, when Back to the Future 1 was released. So here's downtown Hill Valley in 1985, and a little bit different story. So here it is, X-rated movie theaters, homeless on the street. The parking lot behind the homeless guy was the plaza. They paved it over. And they had absolutely thrown it away. So this next clip takes you out to the new center of town. And you know where it is. It's the regional mall, where all the activity has gone. And by the way, they also named the mall after that poor lone pine tree that had to go. So that's the history of the late 20th century. And what did it get us? Well, again, a lot of unintended consequences. The social exclusion of low-income people, the racial exclusion, the incredible segregation, all sorts of other unintended, the public health epidemic that we've suffered. The research is in that driving makes you fat. We know that. And that the reason that America is so overweight and suffering from asthma and diabetes is 40-50% causally connected to our built environment. But the other thing is climate change. And so we now know that the built environment is responsible for 73% of greenhouse gas emissions. It's about 40+% for the buildings, 30-some% for our transportation system, which is almost entirely cars, therefore oil-based. And so it's the number one way that we are polluting this planet is the built environment. And where is that greenhouse gas emissions coming from? This is Chicago. The lake is on the right. Downtown Chicago is that deep blue. And then the fringe suburbs are the red out on that semicircle ring on the left-hand side. The blue is 2.5 tons of CO2 per year per household. The red is 12 tons, 5 times as much. We know where the CO2 is coming from. It's out on the fringe, high density, walkable urban places. We now know that if you move a a household from that drivable suburban fringe into a walkable urban place, you reduce their greenhouse gas emissions by between 50 and 80%. And again, just to refer to the last slide, it's the majority, vast majority, of the reason for our contribution to climate change in this country. So then a funny thing happened. But back in the mid-90s, all of a sudden, the market started to shift. And we did not expect that. That all of a sudden, downtown started coming around. That Cambridge started turning around. And we had no idea what was going on. All these neighborhoods that were literally slums were beginning to revive. And we had no idea. This didn't fit any of the models that we had. And this was the beginning, somewhere in the mid-90s, of pushing the pendulum back to building walkable urban places. So, Back to the Future 2 nailed it. Now, by the way, don't pay attention to Back to the Future 3, it's worthless. But Back to the Future 2 goes to the future of Hill Valley. So, this is the distant future. It's a near distant future when this film came out in 1986. And so here is downtown Hill Valley in that near distant future of 2015. So here it is, that the plaza's back. It's been animated again. Happens to have a water feature. But all the buildings have been redeveloped. Some have been torn down and turned into larger buildings, but the whole place is back. People on the street, it's vital. They got everything right except one thing, flying cars. They always promise us flying cars, we never get flying cars. Not that I would want. So this is what's happened to us. And heaven forbid, just shockingly, that these writers back in Universal Studios got it 30 years ago. So there's a lot of signs about how this is happening, but there's just one that I want to point out. How this is already affecting our lives for the better, as far as climate change in particular. And that is that in economics, there's been an ironclad rule for the last 100 years that as GDP went up, vehicle miles traveled, the most common way of measuring car usage, went up in lockstep. Or went down. When GDP went down in a recession, that vehicle miles traveled would go down in a recession. And that happened for literally 100 years until it peaked in 2005. 2005 is peak driving in this country. And it is down about 10% on a per capita basis. For young people, that driving peaked in 2001, young people, 18 through 34, peaked in 2001. 2001, gas prices were as cheap as they were when I was in high school. They were as cheap as they've been in half a century. That's when young people started to drive less. Young people driving on a per capita basis is down by one third. And I'm sure you all have stories of your kids that don't have a driver's license. Or don't want a car. And the reason is we all know the reason, is that this is the most important thing in their life. This expresses them personally far more than a muscle car. And where's the one place you can't use this? In a car. So we're seeing a lot of signs of this impact. The thing is that building this smart growth, walkable urban future is fundamentally different than how we built the drivable suburban past. It's an entirely different skill set. And I liken that how we that cut our teeth on drivable suburban development, we got very good at driving NASCARs. NASCARs are engineered to go straight or turn left. They can't turn right, they can only turn left, which is somewhat ironic from a political point of view, given NASCAR racers, and going 150 miles an hour. What we have to learn how to do is fly fighter jets, which is to go straight, turn right, turn left, go up 5 miles or crash and burn in seconds, going 600 miles an hour while you're being shot at. This is a fundamentally different skill set. And this means that virtually every rule you knew, every experience you understood driving that NASCAR does not apply. And one of the experiences that we learned with NASCARs, as far in the NASCAR era of building the built environment, is that as you built more drivable suburban development, the quality of life went down. It's more is less. And it was the reality of it, that the suburbs, we were promised open space, ease of getting around by car, and, you know, clean air and no pollution. And as we built the next subdivision and the next strip mall, all of that stuff went away. The end result of that was the largest political movement of the last half century in this country, which is the rise of neighborhood groups. Neighborhood groups, none, nada. I'm sure for the rest of you gray hairs out there, you didn't have neighborhood groups. We had Boy Scouts and we had PTA and we had churches, but we didn't have neighborhood groups. Today, virtually every neighborhood in this country is organized. And the reason they're organized is to fight development. They're fighting drivable suburban development, and it was rational. More is less. Fight the stuff that will decrease your quality of life. Right now, walkable urban works under a fundamentally different principle. It's that each new element that you add to a walkable urban place makes it better. It's more is better. That the next restaurant that gets added adds more choice, adds more people on the street, increases property values, increases property taxes, and you start an upward spiral. It's more is better. Now, having said that, you've got to address the unintended consequences. No such thing as a free lunch, that we have a massive affordable housing problem. And so you have to address both at once, at the same time. We've learned this over the last 20 years. Focus on economic development, absolutely. But also, skim off the top of the gentrification and recycle it into a social equity program. And that's the job that the CAC has taken on. So let me share with you just very quickly a couple slides about Boston. This is the Boston research. And again, we just did, this is done in joint venture with MAPC and with the Dukakis Center at Northeastern. And Stephanie Pollack was the point person for the local point person. Stephanie left this project a month early because she got the worst timing for a new job in the history of womankind, when she, as you know, was named Secretary of Transportation about 2 days before the snow started falling. But there is nobody better to do that job than Stephanie. She's just amazing. So we looked at 100% of the land use in Boston for the first time. Nobody's ever done this in any metropolitan area in the country. There's 5.5 billion square feet of space in metropolitan Boston, which is 3,100 square miles in size. Nobody's ever bothered to count it. And it drops into these different product types. So hotels are 1% of the total square footage. That industrial is 5%, rental apartments are 5%, office is 6%. For sale residential is 63%. It's by far the largest. And then when you add to that rental apartments, it's 68% of the square footage of Metro Boston is residential. That's probably the case in most metro areas. It's somewhere in that range. So 2/3 of the square footage is where we live. The other 1/3, roughly, is where we make our living. Now, of course, more and more people are working from home, so that's now blurred. But nobody's ever known in this country what the breakdown of this largest of all asset classes, the built environment, is. And for the first time ever in Boston, we figured that out. The other thing is, we looked at the last three real estate cycles, the 1990s, the 2000s, and the present cycle, and looked at the market share of the growth in that cycle between walkable urban development and drivable suburban development. Again, nobody's ever done this before. And in the 90s, 27% of the square footage that was built and delivered in the 1990s was walkable urban. In the 2000s, it was 39%. Today, it's 49%. Obviously, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to see that trend line. We're working under the assumption, it's a hypothesis right now, but we think in the future, 80% of all development is going to be walkable urban for at least a generation. The other incredibly important thing to mention is that, and I didn't put up the map here of Metro Boston, but we identified where this walkable urban stuff is. And we counted all the land that is walkable urban. It totals, of the 3,100 square miles, all of 5.6% of metropolitan Boston is walkable urban. The other 94% is drivable suburban sprawl. And that 5.6% is where 41% of jobs are in this region and 40% of the population. And as I say, we think 80% of future development is going to go to walkable urban. And maybe that, you know, hopefully that 5.6% will increase, because the number one reason there is gentrification, number one reason, is land prices. And we have no shortage of land. You've got no shortage of land. 5.6%, that's it. If you made it 8%, 9% of the land was walkable urban, you would really deal with a large chunk of the affordable housing problem just by doing that. And it would behoove you to learn from a couple other examples throughout the country. There's right now, you know, 10 years ago, we didn't have these models. Today, we do. There's a lot of folks that are doing some amazing things. I mean, you've heard of Portland and Seattle, and Denver's doing some great stuff. Washington has some great models. In particular, one for you is Arlington, Virginia. It's the smallest county in the country, about 225,000 people, right across the Potomac from the District of Columbia. It's a very diverse place. Their public schools speak 90 languages. This is not a prissy white suburb, though there's elements that are prissy white. But it's an all-American town. This is where federal workers would find a cheap house to buy. That's what Arlington's always been. Well, Arlington was being disinvested in the 1970s, 1980s, as sprawl was taking development further out. On the left here is one of their currently walkable urban places, but that's what it looked like in the mid-80s. That was a former Sears store that left to go out to the mall out on the Beltway. And they just left the building behind. On the left is the store, on the right was the garden center. Where the picture was taken was the car and tire center, just abandoned. And also Arlington was seeing that all the car dealers were leaving. They were going out to the Beltway as well. So there, the walkable urban places in Arlington total 10% of their land mass. Their tax base in the mid-80s for that 10% was 20% of their gross revenues and falling for obvious reasons. Here's a picture from the exact same perspective today. What you're looking at is the Apple Store, Whole Foods, $600 per square foot condos, and two blocks from here, it feathers back to single family housing. And that single family housing happens to be the most expensive single family housing in Arlington, because that they can live in the suburbs and walk to 50 restaurants and the metro station. And the other thing that's happened is that That 10% of the land now represents 55% of their tax base. They've shifted their tax base entirely to that 10% of their land. That's what's funding their schools. They went through this recession without any real concern because they have this incredible, you know, this incredible cash cow that's generating great benefits to their community, and they don't have to raise property taxes. All coming out of that 10%. So going back to Boston, the other thing that we looked at was the social equity of these places, and we examined these places on the criteria of housing and transportation and opportunity, and we ranked them on how well they were performing. And they cluster in two big clusters, upper left-hand corner, lower right-hand corner. What we saw down in Washington, what we've seen elsewhere, is that we have places that have high opportunity and low social equity. And then we have places that have low opportunity. Pardon? So, yes, yeah. On the left is accessibility and opportunity. The y-axis is affordability. And that's affordability both for housing and transportation. So, and this is available online, of course. So, and so what we have is two different kinds of places. We have places throughout the country that have high opportunity, low social equity. That needs a different social equity strategy than one that has low opportunity and higher social equity. Requires a different strategy. So what we're hoping to do here in Boston that Barr has asked us to do is to figure out, you know, put on the ground a strategy for each. How can we go to two different places? And Somerville, because of the mayor, is why we're here for one of those two. The other interesting thing to note in the research, talked about housing and transportation, that the average household income dedicated to housing and transportation for drivable suburban places, they're spending 48% of their household income. 48% of their household income is going to their mortgage, their rent, and maintaining a fleet of cars. With walkable urban households, the average is 43%. So they may be spending more on housing because of the shortage of walkable urban housing and the outrageous price of land, because we don't have enough walkable urban land, but they're not spending it on transportation. Generally speaking, for household wealth creation, housing grows over time. Always, cars depreciate. So this is really helping build wealth for our households. The third leg of the stool is place management. This is a new level of governance in our society. It's a missing level of governance. We have federal, state, local. Underneath local is place management. You need a 24/7 place manager to make sure that whatever strategy you come up with gets implemented and that there's people worrying about it every day of the week. And we're seeing great place management organizations throughout the country. Arlington has a lot, but you know, New York has great business improvement districts. It doesn't have to take the form of BIDs. There's other forms that it can take, main streets. But you need a place manager to implement this stuff. So if the strategy is a parking strategy, if it's a park strategy, if it's a clean and safe strategy, if it's a job training strategy, if it's an affordable housing strategy, the place manager is the one to manage the entire process. They don't have to do everything, but they're the ones that understand where all this stuff is going and encourage the people that are doing the affordable housing to do it, or finding them the resources. They're the ones that may do the economic development planning. They may do the parking management, but they're the ones responsible for all the aspects of the strategy that I'm suggesting that you develop. Generally speaking, the place management models in this country, 90% of them are private funded. It's what I refer to as a private-public partnership. I intentionally switched that phrase. Now, there are some very good public place managers. Montgomery County, Maryland has some very good public place managers. Paris has fabulous public place managers. But 90% of the models that we know of that are really, you know, great national models tend to be private-led with public participation. And what do they do? And how does it start? It tends to, I mean, and you don't run before you walk. It tends to start on the left with, and this is the main thing. Two things I learned at Harvard Business School. One was buy low, sell high. That was the most important thing. The other thing was how to organize, you know, different types of organizations. Three types. Number one, a cost center, where you have a mission and you generate no revenue and you're hired to do that mission and you're paid and you're given a budget to do it. That's known as a cost center. Most public services are cost centers. You don't pay the police personally when they come and provide a service for you, unless they take a bribe. They don't take a bribe here. I know they don't. So cost centers are, you know, the clean and safe functions and the functions that are sort of everyday needs. And that's generally where place management starts, that it starts with clean and safe. It then moves into a profit center where they begin to manage other services. They could manage the parking, for instance. They can manage the parks. They create festivals. They begin to generate revenue for doing services, and they hopefully generate a surplus in providing those services that can then be reinvested in the place. And you move into a profit center. And again, a lot of these place managers are very heavily involved in programming, particularly with parks. Parks must be programmed. There's got to be something happening almost every day of the year, and just activity generating look for lots of different people in the community and bringing people in from outside. And then it moves into an investment center where the place manager is raising capital to build parks, raising capital to build transportation systems, raising capital to build parking decks, and getting a return on that capital as it manages those assets. So we're seeing, in essence, this level of governance is growing into a very, very substantial governance level for this country. And I think it's crucial for the future as far as walkable urban development. So this is the outline, and we have an outline for you that we'll leave behind as a little two-pager that gives a bit more detail on this. And it starts with making sure that we all understand, and particularly I need to understand this, the various issues that you've been talking about working on for the last number of years, really. I mean, the CAC has been around for a couple of years, but before that, you know, Summer Vision and all, I mean, you've done some remarkable work. You've done a lot of the heavy lifting. What I'm hoping this process will do will bring it to closure. But taking all that information about the vision, about the infrastructure, about programs that are needed, that needs to make sure that everybody on the CAC and anybody else involved with this process will be up to speed. So day one, this is a two one-day sessions, and it's over as far as the crafting of a strategy and an action plan. So first day, and I'm not certain you need a full day on this because you've done so much work on this stuff that you might know much of this anyway. So we'll work with WIG and others to figure out whether it's a full 8 hours or maybe it's a half day. And that's just to make sure everybody's up to speed. This works under the assumption, this is my Quaker background, works under the assumption that you bring people together, people of goodwill come together, you educate everybody about the same stuff, they all know the same thing, and then you give them what I refer to as the universe of options. That's going to be on day two. of what this, what the skeleton is of a strategy. So day one is for education. Day two is to craft a strategy and an action plan. And we have a deck of cards that I've developed over many, many years doing these downtown strategies throughout the country. It's about 45 cards that break into about 9 categories. This is a skeleton. My experience is that most places pick anywhere from 12 to 20 of these cards to represent what they want to achieve over the next 3 to 5 years. And the strategy is developed in the morning. In the afternoon, it rolls into the action plan. We go back through the strategy that you just developed. And the people that are in the room, it's critical, of course, to have all the people that are decision makers in the room, because this is where the rubber meets the road, better yet, the steel meets the rail, is that we need individuals in that room to volunteer to lead each of the individual actions. So in downtown Chattanooga, one of my favorite places, I've worked on it when it was a down in the dumps, former industrial town that had lost all of its pig iron manufacturing to what it is today, one of the great small town turnaround stories in the world. And there were 14 different things, and one of them was to build a circulator system, a free battery-powered circulator system, because they wanted to be the most environmentally friendly town on the planet. And somebody volunteered to do it. Within a year, they had found a local entrepreneur, because we couldn't find a vendor of battery-powered buses back in the late 80s, early 90s. So an entrepreneur stepped forward and started building them and created a whole new export business for Chattanooga. The buses had been sent worldwide. We needed to build they wanted a freshwater aquarium. They privately raised $50 million for the world's largest freshwater aquarium. They went through a whole series of other steps that these folks coming together said, damn it, we're going to turn this downtown around. And within 3.5 years, the 14 items were done. We had to craft a new strategy. And they went through that in about 5 years. And that leads, of course, to the community benefits agreement, which is embedded in all this stuff. Because all the good stuff that you want in the community benefits agreement is all part of the strategy. But you have to find ways to pay for it. And so there's a lot of examples of CBAs that we could point to. But the one that I like that's most comparable, it's not as comparable, it's just the demographics are different, but there's a place called Hempstead, Long Island. It's east of New York City, and it's a poor town surrounded by a lot of rich white towns, and here is a minority-based town, and they've got a CBA that one of the locus partners, developers, put in place, and they're the master developer of this downtown. And it involves education of the workforce. It involves, obviously, local hiring. It involves improvement in the education system itself. It involves affordable housing. And it's laid out and it's all part of the strategy for the turnaround of downtown Hempstead. It's part and parcel. The other things that we're hoping to do, we don't have the funding for it yet, but we just met with the Boston Foundation today and 50-50, 60-40, we'll find out. We need to do some economic projections of what this strategy means to you, the town. What's going to happen to your tax base? Because hopefully what's going to happen to your tax base is what's happening like in Arlington. Because one of the problems economically that Boston has in general is your out of control property taxes. You all feel it personally, but you're eating into your nest egg. You're eating your seed corn by the property taxes that you're charging. And this strategy can help rebalance that. And then, most importantly, figure out the place management. Who's going to be responsible for making this happen? We have a lot of models out there, and hopefully you'll check one. And then we have this action plan. The action plan has deadlines on the next action step. And what we do is every 3 months, or 2 months, or whatever it seems appropriate, get back together for a couple hours. And the individuals responsible for figuring out park management then reports back to the group, this is what I found. And this is where I think I'm going next. And you come up with a new action plan. And we have found it's very effective to have this citizen-led effort to start to implement this stuff. And then of course, the citizen work begins to tail off as the place management organization takes over. But there'll still be a lot of citizen involvement because again, the place management's not doing 100%, they're just managing the entire process. So that's what we're suggesting. And I'd like to also introduce Victoria. Victoria is our new staff member here in Boston for Locus. And she has extensive experience in the Boston region. Her most recent job was in the governor's office of the last administration, running programs that are similar to what we're talking about here. So she has a lot of connections that will prove very, very useful. So with that, open up to questions and see if this is something that you all want to do. Yes?
Hi. It's a mixed income neighborhood, so there's a low-income housing development in the neighborhood. And right now, that area is completely cut off from the proposed development in D2. Like, there is literally a wall. I've been to these meetings for the past year. So far, none of these meetings have addressed the question of how the development is the the plan for, because that is, that's what's happening now. And it's happening, I mean, it's certainly happening for our families, but it's happening for pretty much everybody that I know in the city. And I also haven't seen that addressed in these meetings. And the trajectory of thinking about kind of central set costs to retail development, to long-term infrastructure, growth of like transit investment, and all the rest of that. I mean, that's obviously like what we're seeing in Union Square, like that is a reflection of one facet. But it doesn't strike me that addresses some of the more granular needs and the direct impacts of the development of those parcels is currently having on people who are living in the city. And so I guess that would be my question. How does a two-day CBA process kind of give us space to address that direct question about Allen Street and the larger scale question of how that impacts specifically the exodus of people? That's a good question.
Sure. Because you're asking the entire social equity strategy that it probably won't be finished at the end of the 2 days, but there'll be a framework and there'll be a organization in place that will be responsible for coming up with the affordable housing or the public health needs in the region. And public health in particular, close to my heart. I have a daughter and daughter-in-law that are both in public health. And so, you know, what is those strategies? I mean, I'm not gonna tell you what they are because I have no idea. One thing that I can point out is in other places throughout the country that, you know, the challenge here is we've got a lot of probably obsolete housing that needs renovation. It needs to be upgraded. And we have a density that is a 19th century density. We know that these places both work better and they reduce climate change more as we get higher densities. And so the question is, can we add densities with no displacement? In Chattanooga, in a downtown adjacent place, this is not in a downtown, that the Chattanooga Neighborhood Enterprises, a friend of mine ran this, I was deeply involved with him for many, many years, they went into a neighborhood that had a lot of abandonment and a lot of housing that it was completely run down. It was a minority neighborhood. After 15 years, they had doubled the amount of housing. They had repaired 100% of the housing with one person being displaced, and that one person was judged to be mentally ill. And that was it. No other displacement in this entire neighborhood. But doubled the amount of housing. Another locust developer down in New Orleans, Preskavikoff, has been going into the 1940s, 1950s public housing projects that are also decayed. Very low, you know, relatively low density. And tripling the density, rehabbing all of the affordable housing, tripling the density with market rate housing, and the market rate housing paid for the rehab of the various affordable housing, thus creating a mixed income community. So those are two examples.
One of my questions is how is the development that's happening literally 2 blocks away going to impact that neighborhood in terms of the value of the property? The other question is, if that's the case, like when can we get numbers on the types and amount of housing that's going to go into the
that I can't answer. I mean, I don't know.
Well, you have a neighborhood planning process that's happening now. I assume many, if not all of you here, have been participating in many others. You mentioned, you know, how do we
some of the values you're concerned about in your experience and the families you serve are experiencing, how, what are the strategies to deal with it. So you're going to be empowered, you're empowered to help figure that out. So as the neighborhood planning process and the development plan comes clearer, and we can calculate the value of that, and we can calculate the economic impact of that, at the same time, simultaneously, that the goal here is to empower community to develop a strategy, to own the strategy, and not for any of us to prescribe that behind closed doors, to draft that behind closed doors. We haven't got strategies for it, but we have many initiatives around the city, including the Sustainable Neighborhood Initiative, and Joe Beckman and others involved in that as a community-based strategy. But in terms of Union Square, we're trying to develop a model that is unique. We want that as the impact positively for Union Square to be a model for us moving forward, and for other, you know, for around the country. And that's really reconcile the planning and the initiative-based the initiatives with community empowerment to accomplish that. And maybe 2 days won't be enough, but I know, see, a lot of people in this room have done a lot of work over the last many, many months on these issues. So we are much farther ahead than any other community where we ask Chris Lineberg and Lopez to be coming into. This community is cerebral about these issues. This community is active about these issues. I hear from you all the time. So I think we're going to get a good sense of a skeleton, as you call it, framework from day one. But we'll take as much time as we need to develop a strategy. We all need to own it. I'm not going to attempt to prescribe it or write it down. That's not the goal here. Locus is here to work with us to figure that out, not to tell you what we're going to do. That was not something I wanted to entertain, none of us wanted.
My job is just to bring, A, bring the process, B, bring examples from throughout the country. Yes?
Hi. My name is Betty Weed. I'm also a member of Union United, which is a community coalition of residents and business owners and faith communities and community organizations. We've been working together for over a year on a lot of the issues that you're describing here. And my question is, you were talking about a two-day, the strategy and action plan, like two-day kind of meeting. And I'm not clear from what you're describing here, who gets to be at that meeting? Is that an open meeting for all, you know, residents of Somerville, or who's in that conversation?
As I understand it, CAC has been designated as the board of Union Square. The other thing is that you need at the table people that are going to have interesting things and important things to add to the process, and the decision makers to make those decisions at the time. Because we have to make decisions, I would suggest, that people all agree to at the moment, rather than drag this stuff out for interminable night meetings and, you know, wait until you finally figure out what to do, you know, 3-4 years from now.
So the community's not going to have direct involvement?
The community will be at the session if they want to be. But the people that are, you know, this is the CAC's mission.
CAC is a representative of 30 representatives of the community, including Union United, on the CAC. We expect everyone who wants to be at the table there to facilitate around. But much like the Somerville by Design process, everyone's engaged now. Everyone has a stake in what we're doing here, whether you're part of an organization or not, whether you're part of Union United or Main Street, so you just happen to live here. You moved in the last 6 months, or you've been here 60 years, you have a stake in that. We want you at the table. It's going to be what we're doing as we outline this back many, many months with the CAC. We've increased representation there, but that doesn't mean any individual doesn't have a say in what we're doing. If you want to take ownership of an issue, hey, step up. There's a process here to have yourself heard.
You mentioned that the decision makers are going to be in the room. Is that going to include the Somerville Redevelopment Authority?
You tell me.
If it makes sense.
Yeah.
So they're the ones that are going to be making the decisions, right?
Well, let me just say this. I said at the outset of this meeting, I purposely and strategically stepped back. I want to see this process that is advantageous to have that candid engagement involvement. If I need to be there, I'm going to be there. Representatives of the SRA have to be there, they'll be there. But what I want is open, candid dialogue, that we all need that in this process. So whatever is needed to make the process work, maybe we all may decide it's needed. You know what? We don't want people there. We want all these other people there. I think let's leave it dynamic and let it evolve.
I do believe that the developer needs to be there, because they're going to be making plans and commitments. They need to be part of this process. The thing about these places is, again, more is better, and we're all in this together. This isn't, if you turn it into a combative process, you all lose. You're shooting yourself in the foot. And the vitality that's going to make this a very special place will go someplace else. And so, you know, you can make yourself attractive and vital and be the place you want to be, or you can squabble and point fingers. But that's not the way these places are now working. There's a place outside of Washington called the Pike District, out in the suburbs. Bunch of strip malls. It's strip mall hell. And, you know, 8 lanes of traffic, 90 bisectors, Rockville, Pike. And the neighborhoods got together and said, we want this to be like downtown Bethesda. We want our children to be able to walk to get an ice cream cone. Because who would let their child near, you know, close to 8 lanes of traffic? They came together, worked with the developers. The strip malls are being bulldozed right now. There's a big regional mall that's being bulldozed right now. And the community now, you know, the big economic development thing happening in D.C. right now is that Marriott is moving their headquarters. And there's a little article here, Marriott, I can leave them with you, that the neighborhood group got together, raised their own dues, and they've placed ads in front of the current Marriott headquarters, which is in a business park, to say, because Marriott has one criteria with their move, it must be a walkable urban transit served location.
Well, that's pretty amazing.
Number, just one. And we just did a study of 500 corporate headquarters moves. Almost all of them went to walkable urban places. And it's all because they want to attract young people. And they want to be in a hip place that has lots of options. Marriott's doing the same thing. And so this article from last week is about how the Marriott management drive into this business park that's about to be probably bulldozed. The business park's a toast. And they see all these ads saying, move to the Pike District. You're welcome. We'd love you to come here. We'd love you to be our neighbor. That's working together to make the place vital.
I'll try this again.
Chris, just zooming back to talk about process a little bit, can you describe the process beyond these 2 days and how it dovetails into the neighborhood development and the US 2 development process?
How it dovetails with their development process? Well, we'll all know more about the development process, what the US 2 developers know. And so, we'll both, hopefully, if we have the funding from the Boston Foundation, be able to look at it from a financial point of view, what impact it has on this community, and we'll be able to see how these, you know, which developments go first. One of the things we know about the redevelopment of a place is that it needs to focus. It's kind of a block-by-block way of building, of rebuilding our towns.
Chris, I want to say 3 things. First of all, welcome to Somerville.
Thank you.
Second, I want to say that this is the second time that Barr has spent money that I think is great. I won't tell you about the first. I'll tell you offline. Now, my third issue is just, I won't tell you how to do your job because you obviously know how to do it well. But one of the things I would ask as a 30-year member of this community is that part of the process, in my opinion, needs to be, you shared so much tonight that I think is really fine-grained material, and I'm not sure that our community has really understood it. I think one of the issues of choices, how those choices get made, and how we pay for those choices is an issue that I still don't think we, as a understand. And what I would ask is that part of the process, when you speak to the public or to the group, that, or anyone speaks to the group, that you ask in return, before you respond to their question, you ask them to tell you, what did they hear you say? Because it seems to me that a lot of people come to these processes with their own frame. They're stuck in that frame even for the totality of 2 days, continue to hear what is going on here, but don't really hear what's being shared. And my sense is that if any people here are going to invest the 2 days, it seems to me that the contract that needs to be developed is that we're going to truly hear each other. And that has to go both ways. And if it doesn't go both ways, if after all you've said tonight, so little is understood about what you said, then we really haven't gone very far. And the 2 days that you're going to invest, that people are going to invest, are not going to be very well spent. And then the money that both Barr and hopefully the Boston Foundation puts into this process will not have gotten us very far. And I really think that the model that needs to come out of this is that all the stakeholders can really sort of hear better. Because I think if we're better listeners and hear better, we'll come up with better solutions. And that's not just some, you know, cosmic, you know, granola kind of thing. Because I just think that one of the things that this community has not done well, in my opinion, as a 30-year member of this community, is that we do not listen to each other well.
Just one quick comment, which is the other issue that is the flip side of that is trust. And, you know, judging and not trusting the motives of your other neighbors.
Yes.
Go ahead.
So, my name is Ben. I'm actually United. Just for your point, I have notes upon notes and questions, but I just really want to hammer on one thing that you've been talking about, is the importance of financing these managements. How are you proposing that they be financed? Because you have a nice plan here, but you haven't talked about the fact of where money's coming from. So I just want to make that clear.
Again, this isn't my plan, so I can just tell you what's happened elsewhere.
Okay, can you?
Sure. So in established places that have a base of income-producing property owners, it's generally through, and if you take the approach of a business improvement district, it's through their voluntarily raising their taxes on themselves, and that funds the place management organization. So in downtown Albuquerque, we created a downtown business improvement district, and all the property owners raised their taxes about 7%. And that raised about $750,000 to $800,000 per year. That was used for what was very important, was a clean and safe program. That was the most important thing, but it was considered dangerous and it was pretty good. And got into and began running some festivals and began some economic development.
So
that's one example.
Right. So, but to be clear, it's not the developer comes in and we're asking for X amount of money to do whatever.
There's also that.
I mean, I'm just trying to understand your thing.
And there, in Hempstead, the master developer is making some commitments over time based upon the development moving forward at a pace that then development or then funding commitments are made to fund certain programs that are part of the community benefits agreement. So there, the developer is making.
And then, what about things like open space, affordable housing, which are part of inclusionary zoning, extra things like that? How does that work?
You know, open space. it's a fabulous model, and you may think it's not comparable, but it's just so good of it. It's such a great model. Bryant Park in New York. Bryant Park's a 5-acre park.
Great model.
It's just killer. And it was 15 years ago known as Needle Park. It was managed by the city for $150,000 per year, and for that, the city of New York got the best drug dealing center in Midtown Manhattan. And the private sector comes in, takes it over, privately raises the money to fundamentally improve the park, foundations, corporations, and now they fund a $12 million per year operation, 85% from the park. Only 15% from the property owners assessing themselves the tax. And so it went from a pain in the neck for the city with a real nuisance to who couldn't make a lot of money if you had 5 acres at 42nd and Broadway. It's just a mindset. So parks can be managed. I mean, we now know so many great ways to manage parks that could be, I mean, I'm not going to guarantee that you can internally finance it and it might take time to get there. We now have models that.
So essentially, this current CBAs that I've seen, for instance, that would be something that we would say, you know, we want, as part of the demand, we want, you know, X amount of open space. Your model is, we're not doing that, and we're saying, you know, you're gonna help us raise this type of money, and we'll figure out where this open space is going. I mean, I'm just
sure. Confused. It's, you craft a strategy. And then the question is, so how do we pay for it? And what are the funding mechanisms to pay for it? As opposed to a contract that says, you know, if you don't do this, see you in court.
Can I say something comparable local? I mean, we didn't have this type of process, and a lot of people in this room, many people here were part of driving that process at Assembly. We have a 6-acre bachelor park. The boardwalk connecting the banks of the Mystic River, which opened up the entire Fells Reservation, the T station with $15 million of that, and many, many other things were direct. You know, the process was different than we got there, but we learned so much about it. It's successful.
We did learn a lot.
The fireworks events, you know, the things there, you know, we got, but it's very comparable in terms of the values that were important and how we got there were different, but that's taught us so much about why we need to think about this. So yeah, hey, it could be where there's an overlay plan for that. It could be well, we just want this developer to build so many acres, or you know, they give us so many $1 million to do that. We got to figure that out.
There's going to be about 100 solutions to those various requests and needs.
Over there, yeah. Again, form the Civic Advisory Committee, which you can be a member. I thank you for your work and activism, and we want more to be involved. Community has to be part of the conversation, and will be part of the conversation. It's going to work. We have not attempted to newly draft or prescribe what the CBA should be. I think we'll go back to the lessons locally. We know the things we advocated, fought, or litigated for were important and successful. There are some things. You know, that taught us, you know, where maybe if we could go a little far back a little bit, we could involve a different process. We would have done some other things differently. Well, I appreciate the work. CAC is representing the community as well. You're a part of that. They represent businesses and residents, and everyone is participating in it, much akin to the planning process, some old by design. No one group dominates. Every person, individual, whether you want to be part of a group or not, has a say. And then when you live here for a couple months or say all your life, You're part of an organized group or not, you're welcome. We want you, your work is well appreciated and will inform us moving forward. You probably discovered the many same models that Chris speaks about, or maybe it is something we don't know about. Let's hear it. We are not going to attempt to prescribe to you what this should be, what our values are as a community that will come forward. We'll all want it together. I'm going to come back over there. Yes. You. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Tori Antonino. I'm on the Green and Open Space Subcommittee, the CAC. And a few questions. In this process, and I think I really like you, so I just want to say So, in this process, would you be helping us, because we lack green and open space, we are desperate for green space, would you help us negotiate with the developers, perhaps in the CBC, in requiring them to, you know, allot a certain amount of open space in their development? Would you help us in strategizing how we can acquire more green and open space? And thirdly, have you had examples where you've worked with zoning regulations in other cities, because we are having a zoning overhaul and we're trying to figure out, okay, you know, how do we, where does green and open space and what are our standards? So those are my three main questions. And as a side note, I would like to talk to you later, and I'm interested in your son and daughter's perspective. If they're in the public health sector, what your stance is on artificial turf. So primarily, it's a lot of fun. Primarily, you know, working with the zoning regulations, the developers, and acquiring lands in green and open space. Thank you.
Sure. On the artificial turf,
yeah.
My son and daughter-in-law are in San Diego, and their lawns being ripped up to native planting, which is what it should be. I have a development partner who developed a project in Florida called Seaside on the Panhandle. It's the first new urbanist project. And his two-page neighborhood regulations include no lawns, only native plantings. Now, the reason for that, by the way, back when he put that together, it wasn't for environmental reasons, though he came to realize how lovely it is environmentally. The reason is he didn't like to hear lawnmowers at 10 a.m. Saturday morning when he was trying to sleep in. But the most toxic places in our country are golf courses, and second are our lawns. So, I mean, come on, the runoff is just horrendous. I used to be on a board of a bunch of folks that played golf, and when I started talking about that, they sort of pushed me to the side. As far as open space and parks, it's crucial to make walkable urban places work. If you don't have green space, if you don't have open, you know, it's the classic lungs of the city. If you don't have it, none of this stuff works. And ideally, there will be linear trails, whether the linear trails are up and down the track or up and down creeks, daylight creeks that have probably gone underground. Linear trails are one of the most popular things we've seen over the last 20 years. The entire city just adores them because it touches almost everybody. And it gives you bike trails. Biking should be 25-30% of your mode split. Though, of course, last March you might not have been thinking that way. But it is crucial that these trail systems, we work very closely with Rails to Trails. It is, and from a financial point of view, they pay for themselves. As far as the premiums that park fronting development has, they pay for themselves. By the way, another interesting thing that we just learned recently out in Denver is that railroad fronting places are getting price premiums too, because we now have great glass that can insulate the sound. We don't want to hear the sound. But since we spend all of our time looking at a computer screen these days, actually look at something real like a train going by, is now getting price premiums. People are willing to pay more to live in the track-facing units. Go figure. That's not the way it used to be.
Courtney, then I'm going to come back over here.
I just had a question and a comment. My question is, in the action plan process, you mentioned Headstead, Long Island.
Yeah.
My question is, who oversees and enforces that CBA? That's a question that I had. And my comment is, we have a summer vision plan, and we have affordable housing numbers and job numbers and open space numbers. And going along in this process, what I've come to realize is that if those numbers are not realized in Union Square the way that they need to be realized in Union Square, they're not going to be realized anywhere else throughout the city.
Exactly.
So we might as well take the summer vision, which is this really pretty book. I keep it inside my office. It's a big hit with people that I date. But if we don't realize those numbers,
I told you it would.
as they're carefully planned out throughout the entire city, Union Square is our one opportunity and our golden opportunity to really put that plan to work.
We agree completely that what ideally the place manager will be authorized by the city council. And we'll have to come back to the city council every 5 years to be reauthorized. Because they're, generally speaking, these organizations are funded from property taxes. I'm not saying that's what it's going to be, but that's generally how they're funded. And that's a city function. So the city can, and this is also by state legislation that these things get set up. And so the process is every 5 years, you get reauthorized. And so they come forward and say, we're going to do this over the next 5 years. And 5 years later, they're going to be judged based upon what they did and what they're going to do in the next 5 years. This research not just defined the walkable urban places in this region, it came up with two metrics, performance metrics of their economic performance and of their social equity performance. And I think one of the big challenges for urbanism is to come up with other performance metrics. Public health is a particular, that's the next one that we're looking at, is a place-based public health metric, and then environmental. And so this organization, whatever it is, should be held accountable, and we have the measurements that they should be managing towards.
Back.
Go ahead.
Hand up, because we can't hear you.
Do you want the mic?
Yeah.
Do you want to ask a question up
here? I'm good, thank you.
So as far as what a public benefit or a community benefit is, again, that's up to you. I can only tell you what's happened elsewhere. So there have been issues such as, of course, affordable housing, and issues such as public health facilities, issues such as job training, and there's a whole range of public benefit. Parks generally almost always come into play as far as public benefit. And so that's up to you. I can't obviously tell you what public benefit is. The big question therefore becomes, how do you pay for it? Mm. And I don't think the public sector
has the resources. One of our challenges as a society is that we have so taxed ourselves with military, so we have this, you know, Social Security and Medicare that is going to drain all discretionary spending. I'm not particularly proud of my generation that we have not saved for our retirement the way we should have, so we're going to put a drain on our kids. So if you're looking for the public sector to solve that, good luck. It's not going to happen, I don't think. So it's the only other option is the private sector. I just don't see any other answers. Foundations will help you in the short term. They'll come up with a 3-year seed grant to help set up organizations that can deliver services. But unless you generate the revenue yourself locally, I don't see where else the money's coming from. This is really, you know, this doesn't always get a lot of credence, but it's the reality right now. It's a bootstrap. You, the community, have to take responsibility to doing it yourself. The feds aren't going to give you the money. The budget of the city is stretched thin. The only way that's going to do it is bring more people here, more revenues that will start this upward spiral. Now, as far as winners and losers, there's absolutely winners and losers. The winners are the existing property owners. So no matter how poor you may be, as Somerville becomes a more vital place, even more vital than it is today, this is probably going to be their retirement as the property that they own goes up in value. The losers will be the renters, unless you put in a conscious affordable housing strategy for them, and ideally put in an affordable housing strategy for for sale. I built 1,500 affordable housing units in California, and about 80% of them were for sale. We brought them in at 55% of market price, and it was not subsidized, with one notable exception. This was a university, they owned the land, and some land control there. So there are mechanisms, but it's, you know, this is not something that you can just wish away. You're gonna have to do it.
Interesting.
Did I?
So I just wanted to respond to that. Some of those two-thirds renters, so you're proposing a strategy where two-thirds of the city are losers by default unless we figure out a different plan. I think you can understand why people have some reservations about that.
Yeah.
My name is Karen. I live in Union Square. I'm a community organizer. And I'm also part of Union United. So I just wanted to refer to Nancy, who is also a member of Union United as a long time.
I've lived here for 55 years. In that time, I did get a college degree, so I think I am fairly literate, and just to put any questions to rest, I think myself and probably just about everyone else in the room were able to pretty much follow the presentation. I have lived here and worked here all my life. I'm struggling tremendously. I live in a two-room apartment that I can barely afford. I currently pay, because I don't work part-time, probably 80% of my income. When I was employed full-time, I was paying 65% of my income. I'm of a certain age. What I hear in this presentation, and thank you for coming to me and making the presentation, thank you for coming together. But I hear that old, poor, maybe obese, maybe undesirable in other ways, folks like me,
And I'm saying that if the community wants to address those challenges collectively, they're going to have to do it in this local setting. We're trying to get a strategy in place that people can have consensus on, so you can start working as opposed to talking.
I mean, be clear, the reason we started the Sustainable Neighborhood Initiative, and Mark Meaney is one of the co-chairs of that working group, and the reason we're coming forward with a bold and, I'll say, controversial legislative, programmatic, and policy changes is because we attacked the issue, just in the sort of issue, the same way we fight you, you're never going to get caught up. And that's why the other two bills are not going to be losers. We're all in the losing. Because if we're sitting, and we really start to lose our soul along the way. So whatever time we need to get there. This is a starting of a process, to develop a framework to tackle the issue. The old mechanisms, as good as they are, cannot keep pace with the preliminary way of investment in speculation. And I think it was stated earlier, how do we leverage speculation, certainly investing back in ourselves as a community? Not just what we build, but who we are. We have to turn this upside down. It's something different. We can't do it the same way. We can't keep pace. This is the second most gentrifying region in the United States outside of San Francisco. Right now, the median housing price in Boston has surpassed New York City. And we're all feeling it. This is an issue at the forefront. And I commend you for your perseverance. As a rental or homeowner, I can hear that part. I'm sorry. What you pay for housing costs, and we're seeing it across the city. And it is a top issue for us. But we cannot get there with the same mechanism, no matter how well intended they were. We have to turn it upside down. And this focus of me is something that is critical to outline the value, measure the value, manage the future, make sure we continue investing. Let's go back. There was a hand up over here. None? John, do you have a hand?
That's okay. My name is Terry White. I am a member of the
Community Bank. It's an important thing.
I am a 70-year-old adult, and my mom is
just
right in the middle of this lovely mess on Webster Avenue, which we both walked out of and had to go through private property to get into our houses, and all this heavy equipment coming up. I heard a lot of things that you said this evening. Number one that concerns me is diversity. This is an immigrant city and has always been, including my father and my grandmother. Okay, they came to Somerville and to this country for a better life. My father worked three jobs and dropped dead at 58 years old to keep everybody going. I had to go back to work. I become a crossing guard so that I can bring in a little more money. Not to knock you, Mr. Mayor, but the taxes keep going up and I'm the only one that's doing the work to keep it going. It's in my mother's house and I do not want to lose it. Okay, her furniture is still there and so is it my grandmother's furniture. Her dishes as well, two sets of dishes. So, the thing is, the diversity, I've seen this city change over the 7 years and I think it's absolutely fabulous. We have a lot of immigrants coming in, they're establishing themselves, want to lean towards the future, to raise their families here. The trouble is, we seem to have become a transient society in the last few years. I watched them move in and out of the neighborhood over a year, 2 months. We got people across the street, sublet their apartment for the summer, and people come in and they leave in 2 months. Okay? So, and then I heard you talk about cars in emissions that cause respiratory illnesses and sickness. I belong to an organization which is the 1840, and we raise money for children with cystic fibrosis and respiratory illnesses. We donated $24,000 this year to National Jewish Health. We're a group of 5,000 women. Not only are cars a problem, it's the heating in your home, because we've made these homes so airtight, and the heat goes up to 70 or 80 because they can't keep warm, okay? Which is wrong. The doctors have explained to us it's better to have a drafty house and have the heat on 64. That way you put a sweater on and you're not. The colognes, the smoking, the cleaning chemicals that we use in our house. A new baby comes into this house and is immediately affected by this, so it's not just cats. So my question is to you, are you going to keep it an immigrant city? What do you define as affordable housing? What is the rent? I mean, I get $1,800 a month, and I do the best I can to keep my son and myself. How much or how many of these affordable apartments are going to be awarded? how many apartments are going to be built, and how is that going to help the community and still keep the taxes down?
City because you can't raise taxes. The feds are broke. And, you know, in fact, sequestration is cutting federal spending.